وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول
الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على عبد الله ورسوله نبينا وحبيبنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. We begin as always by praising Allah, by asking Allah to exalt the mention and grant peace to our Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to his family and his companions. So we're talking about the rights of the husband and the wife, and we spent the last two episodes really looking at the generic way that the rights of husband and wife are kind of set out in Islam, and looking at how we should approach the right of the husband and the right of the wife in Islam, how we should be approaching it, and the way that we should kind of understand this framework that Islam has set out for us in how the husband and wife deal with one another. So now we're going to look at the rights that are equivalent. Now, it isn't a precise science to a certain extent, in the sense that there are ways you can see certain things to be equivalent, there are ways you can see certain things to be slightly different, or opposite to one another. But generally looking at the things in which the scholars say there is equivalence, there is mumathala tamma, complete equivalence between husband and wife. The very first one we're going to look at is the statement of Allah Azza wa Jal, وَعَاشِرُوهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. This is in Surah An-Nisa, ayah number 19. And live with them with ma'roof. So here the command is to the men regarding the women. It's to the men regarding the women. But this is a right in which the scholars say that there is equivalence. Both the men and women are commanded to live with each other in ma'roof, bil ma'roof, in goodness. So first of all, this is mentioned to the men in relation to the women. Like the Prophet ﷺ said, اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ فِي النِّسَى. Have taqwa of Allah with regard to women. That is also equivalent, right? Because men also have to have taqwa regarding women, and women also have to have taqwa regarding their husbands. So the Prophet ﷺ emphasized it with regard to the husband towards his wife. اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ فِي النِّسَى. Have taqwa of Allah regarding your women. But it's also an equivalent right. It's the husband has to have taqwa with regard to his wife, and the wife has to have taqwa of Allah with regard to the husband. But that's just a separate issue. Here we're going to talk about وَعَاشِرُهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ, living together بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. So first of all, let us ask ourselves the question, what is al-ma'roof? We had already heard what al-Imam al-Sa'di rahimahullah ta'ala said about al-ma'roof in terms of al-ada, al-jariyah, that it is the customs that are ongoing in a particular country, in a particular time, for a particular husband and a particular wife, and for him, for her. نِمِثْلِهَا, you know, for the likes of her and the likes of him. That's the word ma'roof as it relates to customs. But what about the word ma'roof as it relates to goodness? Some of the scholars defined it as saying it is كُلُّ قَوْلٍ حَسَنٍ وَفِعْلٍ جَمِيلٍ وَخُلُقٍ كَامِلٍ. It is every good statement and every beautiful action and every perfect mannerism or perfect character. And that is really, really, it's really scary in a way, because that Allah commanded men to live with their wives like that, and you feel that, how do I achieve everything good in speech and everything beautiful in action and everything exemplary in character? How do I even try to achieve that? But that's what Allah commanded you, to live with them in that state. That the way the man treats his wife, and some of them said this is the greatest right of the wife over her husband, وَعَاشِرُهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. But in reality, it is a right that is equivalent, because she also has to live with her husband in that. So the husband and wife should be working together and striving together for what? كل قول حسن. Every wonderful statement, every wonderful speech could be, you know, the beautiful words he says to his wife. He tells her he loves her. She tells her she loves him. He tells her, you look beautiful. She says, you look lovely. You look nice. SubhanAllah, beautiful words. قول حسن. وفعل جميل. And actions which are beautiful. فعل جميل. Beautiful actions. Really, really kind actions. Could be giving a gift. Could be the way that he, the softness in treating with each, in the way they treat with each other. It could be smiling at each other. And it could be intimacy with one another. كل قول حسن. Every beautiful word and every good word and every beautiful action and every exemplary character. So that exemplary character could be mercy, could be softness, could be gentleness, could be kindness, could be love. Every wonderful exemplary characteristic. وَعَاشِرُوهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. And that is what Allah commanded the men to be towards their wives. And we understand that this is a right which is also a right of the husband over the wife, that she lives with him in the best way. So we have on one side, beautiful speech, or good speech, beautiful action, exemplary character. On the other side, we have what Al-Imam Sa'di said regarding the word ma'ruf, which is to live in accordance with the customs of the particular country and time in which you are, and also in accordance with the status of that man and the status of that woman and their position and their what they have available, the resources they have available to them. Now, it's important to note when it comes to customs, of course, that customs don't overrule Islam. Rather, Islam overrules customs. So if there's a custom in a particular country which is contrary to Islam, and when we talk about nushuz, we might give examples of this, where there is a custom which is contrary to Islam and brings problems into the marriage, then Islam comes first. But generally speaking, the husband lives with the wife with the best of speech, the most beautiful actions, the most exemplary manners. The wife, she lives with the husband with the best of speech, the most beautiful actions, and the most exemplary manners. And they live in accordance with the expectations of what is normal around them. Now, what that just generally means is, I mean, first of all, if the husband and wife agree on something, there is no issue, because it's حقوق العباد, right? The rights of the servants. There's no issue if they agree on something, if they both don't like a particular custom and they don't want to follow it. There's no big issue as long as it doesn't fall into that which is haram. But generally speaking, how should they expect to be with one another? So you look at what is normal. What's normal? What's expected in the country? What's the kind of norms in the time, the country, for that kind of woman, for that kind of man? And that defines whatever is not defined by the Sharia. That's important. That defines whatever is not defined by the Sharia. It's not the case that we put the customs first, as many people do, and that causes huge problems in marriage. They put the customs first and they put the Islamic stuff second. So they say, my custom says that my wife should uncover in front of my brother, for example. They say, well, Allah said, وَعَشِرُوهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ, live with them in the way that is customary. But here, the custom contradicts what the Prophet ﷺ told us and what Allah Azza wa Jalla told us. And so here, we're going to say that that custom is invalid and not given any consideration at all. Rather, the woman, she has to be more careful around her brother-in-law than she would be around a stranger in the street. As the Prophet ﷺ told us that the in-law is death. And so we have to be very careful around the in-laws in terms of the brother-in-law, the sister-in-law, and how the relationship is between them. It has to be that distance and that covering and the hijab and so on. But here, we're just talking about how customs could conflict with Islam. Islam always comes first. But generally speaking, what Islam doesn't define, we go with what is customary. And customs are important because they help to set basic expectations. Yes, husband and wife may both not like a particular custom and culture, and that's perfectly fine for them to leave it. because they're not required to do it. However, it sets some basic expectations. Our next hadith in Bukhari and Muslim from the hadith of Ibn Umar, عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أنه قال ألا كلكم راع وكلكم مسؤول عن رعيته فالأمير الذي على الناس راع وهو مسؤول عن رعيته. Ibn Umar, he said, the messenger, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, indeed all of you are shepherds, i.e. all of you are responsible. All of you are shepherds and all of you are responsible for your flock. The Amir who is over the people, like the governor or the ruler who is over the people, is a shepherd and is responsible for his flock. وَالرَّجُلُ رَاعٍ عَلَىٰ أَهْلِ بَيْتِهِ وَهُوَ مَسْؤُولٌ عَنْهُمْ. And a man is a shepherd over his family and he is responsible for them. وَالْمَرَأَةُ رَاعِيَةٌ عَلَىٰ بَيْتِ بَعْلِهَا وَوَلَدِهِ وَهِيَ مَسْؤُولَةٌ عَنْهُمْ. And a woman, she is responsible for the house of her husband and his children, and she is responsible for them. She's a shepherd and she's responsible for them. وَالْعَبْدُ رَاعٍ عَلَى مَالِ سَيِّدِهِ وَهُوَ مَسْؤُولٌ عَنْ. And a slave is responsible for his owner's wealth, or is a shepherd of his owner's wealth, and he is responsible for it. أَلَا فَكُلُّكُمْ رَاعٍ وَكُلُّكُمْ مَسْعُولٌ عَنْ رَعِيَتِهِ. Indeed, all of you are shepherds and all of you are responsible for your flock. So here, I could have brought this, to be honest, in the segment of how we see the role of the husband and the wife. But I actually wanted to bring it under the topic of al-mumathala, those things which the husband and wife are equal in the sense that they are both equal in responsibility. Husband has responsibility, the wife has responsibility. They're not entirely equal in the sense responsibilities are not the same. They're not the same, but they both have responsibility. And it's not the case that one has responsibility and the other one has, let's say, clothing, for example, or one of them has responsibility and the other one has a house provided for them. The reality is they both have responsibility. They both have things that they are responsible for. And it is the case that the husband is responsible, the wife is responsible. There are some differences in the responsibilities. So the husband is responsible for his household, for Ahli Baytihi. That means he's responsible for everyone living in his household. He's responsible for his wife, for his children, and so on. He is fully responsible for them. And he's a shepherd of them, which means that he has a degree of authority over them and that he is shepherding them, kind of looking after them, taking care of them. And he is mas'oolun anhum, so he will be asked yawm al-qiyamah about them. Likewise, the woman is responsible. So it's not true to say that a woman doesn't have any responsibility or that she doesn't have any things that she will be asked about. Rather, she is responsible for the house of her husband that he has provided for her. We're going to talk about the provision of the house, inshallah ta'ala, in a subsequent episode. He's responsible for that. She's responsible for the house and she's responsible for the children. And that is, again, a beautiful balance in Islam. She is under her husband's responsibility, but her children are under her responsibility and her husband's responsibility as a, you know, for overall, like in terms of the umbrella responsibility. But she is directly responsible for her children, particularly in her husband's absence. So here, she's responsible for his house and she's responsible for his children. And this is really important because it actually helps us with other things, like we talk about women working and things like that. And we talk about the fact that whatever she does, being with her husband's permission, not being haram and so on, but it can't be at the expense of the responsibility, the mas'uliyah that Allah Azza wa Jalla has given to her. That is that she is mas'ul. She is asked, she's mas'ula. عَمْ بَيْتِ بَعْلِهَا وَوَلَدِهِ. the house of her husband and his children. So responsibilities exist for both husband and wife. They're slightly different. The husband's is slightly more comprehensive because it encompasses the wife, and the wife doesn't encompass the husband, but they both have responsibility. And so some of the scholars mentioned this on the area of where there is equivalence, because they both have responsibility. It's not like one has responsibility, the other one has a house and clothing and food provided. Rather, they both have responsibility. But the responsibilities are slightly and somewhat different, because the husband's is overall for the entire household, and the wife's is a subset of that for his house, as in his property, which includes his money. And we've spoken about that previously in terms of a hadith about the, you know, that he feels safe when he leaves his wife, he feels safe about her and about the money and his property that he's left with her. So she's responsible for his property that is under her care. And she is also responsible for his children that are under her care. And the children are going to be within her responsibility, and she's like a shepherd to them. So she's telling them what to do. She's responsible for them. And that's a nice balance, actually, because it tells you that beautiful balance between obedience to the mother and the wife's obedience to the husband, and how those two balance each other out. Because that boy or that young man who is his wife, is he's a shepherd for his wife. His mother is a shepherd for him. So there's a balance there in terms of gender as well, a balance in terms of a man obeying his mother and his father, of course, and a woman obeying a husband, and the balance that is within that system that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed for us. So here, responsibilities are something that both have, and shepherding others are responsibilities that both husband and wife have equally, even though there is a degree of difference in the area of responsibility. Allah Azza wa Jalla said, قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغُضُّوا مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ وَيَحْفَظُوا فُرُوجَهُمْ ذَلِكَ أَزْكَى لَهُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ خَبِيرٌ بِمَا يَصْنَعُونَ وَقُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنَاتِ يَغْضُضْنَ مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِنَّ وَيَحْفَظْنَ فُرُوجَهُنَّ وَلَا يُبْدِينَ زِينَتَهُنَّ إِلَّا مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا وَلْيَضْرِبْنَ بِخُمُرِهِنَّ عَلَى جُيُوبِهِنَّ وَلَا يُبْدِينَ زِينَتَهُنَّ إِلَّا لِبُعُولَتِهِنَّ الْآيَةُ. Allah Azza wa Jalla, he said, say to the believing men to lower their gaze and protect their chastity, that is more pure for them, and Allah is all aware of what they do. And say to the believing women to lower their gaze and to protect their chastity, and not to show their adornment except that which is apparent from it, and let them draw their covering over their head covering over their chests, and let them not show their adornment except to their husbands and to the end of the ayah, their husband, their father, and to the end of the ayah. Here, the equivalence is in guarding the chastity and lowering the gaze. And that is an obligation upon the husband and an obligation upon the wife, that each is satisfied with the other, فحسب, and that's it. Nothing more than that. Neither of them seeks to go beyond the limits that Allah Azza wa Jal set. فَمَنِ ابْتَقَى وَرَاءَ ذَلِكَ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْعَادُونَ. Whoever seeks anything beyond that, whether it be zina, whether it be some of the other fawahish, immoralities and evil things that people do, people watch and people do, all of these things are ma wara'a dhalik. They're outside of what Allah Azza wa Jal has legislated. So Allah has legislated that the husband is satisfied with his wife and lowers his gaze except from her, and that she is satisfied with her husband and she lowers her gaze except from him. And that is one of the major purposes of the marriage that we had spoken about, that the husband lowers his gaze and that the wife lowers her gaze. And we'd spoken about the hadith, يَا مَعْشَرَ الشَّبَابِ مَنِ اسْتَطَعَ مِنْكُمُ الْبَاءَةَ فَلْيَتَزَوَّجْ فَإِنَّهُ أَغَضُّ لِلْبَصَرِ وَأَحْصَنُ لِلْفَرْجِ. That whoever of you young men is able to get married, let him marry, because that is going to help him to lower his gaze and protect his chastity. And that is something which is an equivalent. There is equivalence in the marriage. The woman lowers her gaze except for her husband and protects her chastity except for her husband. And the husband lowers his gaze except for his wife and protects her chastity except for his wife. And that is, as we said, one of the major purposes of the marriage, to prevent and protect the two from az-zina and from an-nadhar ila al-muharram, looking at haram. And as we said, this can, we can take zina as one aspect of it, but subhanAllah, when we talk about looking at haram, that's so common in these days that the husband hasn't taken on the responsibility that he's not going to look at the haram. He's got married, he's got a wife, he's not going to look at the haram. And the wife hasn't taken on the responsibility that when she's got married, she's not going to look at the haram. And that is a big problem in our time. We ask Allah al-afu wal-afiyah. We ask Allah for His pardon. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep us safe from those things. So this is a right which, in which there is equivalence, lowering the gaze and protecting the chastity. We're also going to cover a hadith narrated by al-Bukhari and Muslim from al-Mughira ibn Shu'bah. قال قال سعد بن عبادة لو رأيت رجلا مع امرأتي, that Sa'd ibn Ubada, he said, if I saw a man with my wife, لَضَرَبْتُهُ بِالسَّيْفِ غَيْرَ مُصْفِحٍ عَنْهُ, I would strike him with the sword and I wouldn't let that man go. I would have struck him with my sword and I wouldn't have let that man go. فَبَلَغَ ذَلِكَ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ فَقَالَ أَتَعْجَبُونَ مِنْ غَيْرَةِ سَعْدِ فَوَاللَّهِ لَأَنَا أَغْيَرُ مِنْهُ وَاللَّهُ أَغْيَرُ مِنِّي. The Prophet ﷺ said, are you surprised by the ghayrah of Sa'd, by the protective jealousy of Sa'd? He said that if I saw a man with my wife, I would take my sword and I would go for him and not let him go. I would strike him and I wouldn't let him go. The Prophet ﷺ said, are you amazed by the protective jealousy of Sa'd? By Allah, I am more protectively jealous than him, and Allah is more protectively jealous than me. مِنْ أَجْلِ غَيْرَةِ اللَّهِ حَرَّمَ الْفَوَاحِشَ مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا وَمَا بَطَنْ وَلَا شَخْصَ أَغْيَرُ مِنَ اللَّهِ. Al-Hadith. The Prophet ﷺ said, because of the ghayra of Allah, the ghayra of Allah, Allah made all immorality haram, whatever is apparent and whatever is hidden. And there is no human being, there is nobody who has more ghayra than Allah. More ghayra than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this here in terms of a person refers to al-ghayra, which we might translate to be protective jealousy. As for Allah azza wa jal, then of course, when we apply things to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we apply it in a way that is befitting to His majesty and His perfection subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam explained the ghayra of Allah, that Allah made haram all immorality, what is apparent from it and what is hidden. And there is no one who is more protective of any the limits and more hating of immorality and evil doing than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So here, the reason I brought this hadith is that one of the things in which there is equivalence in is ghayrah, is that both the husband and wife should be protective over one another in a way that is in accordance with the law of Allah Azza wa Jal. Shouldn't be a protective jealousy that leads to suspicion, because Allah Azza wa Jal told us, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا جَتَنِبُوا كَثِيرًا مِنَ الظَّنِّ إِنَّ بَعْضَ الظَّنِّ إِثْمٍ. Or you who believe, keep away from a lot of guessing and suspicion, because indeed some suspicion is sinful. So it shouldn't be the kind of suspicion that is sinful. But protective jealousy, looking after each other and wanting each other to be far away from al-fawahish, from the muharramat, from the filthy acts and immoral acts, and a man taking care that his wife is covered properly, and a wife taking care that her husband is not involved in something that would take away from his honor. All of this is from the ghayra that the husband and wife are supposed to have for one another. And we know the Prophet ﷺ, he said about Aisha radiallahu anha, your mother has had ghayra, your mother has had ghayra. When Aisha she hit one of the wives of the Prophet ﷺ sent a plate of food, and Aisha, she hit it on the floor and she broke the plate. So this is something that the husband and wife are both required to have for one another within the limits set by Allah. When it goes outside of the limits, like when the plate broke, then the Prophet ﷺ took Aisha's plate and replaced the plate with the broken one. But generally speaking, when it doesn't, within the limits, the husband and wife are required to have that. And I remember one of my teachers, may Allah Azza wa Jal preserve him, protect him, I remember him saying that the protective jealousy that a wife has for her husband saves him from so many fitan, so many trials and tribulations, so many problems the husband is saved from because of that. So many muharramat and fahisha he would have fallen into if it wasn't for Allah and then the ghayra of his wife. That she says, who are you talking to? Don't get involved with that person. Don't answer that question. And that is what saves him from so many fitan, from so many fitan. And likewise her, he keeps an eye on the way that she covers and the way that she interacts with people, but it doesn't reach a level that goes into the haram, because ghayra can go over the limit set by Allah Azza wa Jal. And in that case, it is not permissible and it has to be brought back into the limits that are set by Allah Azza wa Jal, like suspicion. And when it reaches the level of suspicion, إِنَّ بَعْضَ الظَّنِّ إِثْمٍ, some suspicion is sinful. Or when it reaches the level of accusations without right, or when it reaches the level of stopping someone from what Allah has made permissible for them, then this is all outside of what we're talking about, the ghayra that is praiseworthy and the ghayra that is something good. The last right that we're going to talk about, which in which there is some degree of mumathala, some degree of equivalence, is the rights relating to the decisions over breastfeeding the children. And this is something some of the scholars mentioned in this, and I'm not going to go into it in too much detail because it's not very common in our time that we give our children to be fed by someone else. It's usually the case that the mother is the one who feeds the child. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said, Allah Azza wa Jal said, فَإِنْ أَرَادَ فِصَالًا عَنْ تَرَاضٍ مِنْهُمَا وَتَشَاوُرٍ فَلَا جُنَاحَ عَلَيْهِمَا وَإِنْ أَرَدْتُمْ أَنْ تَسْتَرْضِعُوا أَوْلَادَكُمْ فَلَا جُنَاحَ عَلَيْكُمْ إِذَا سَلَّمْتُمْ مَا أَتَيْتُمْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَاعْلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ بَصِيرٌ. Allah Azza wa Jal said in the ayah, and if you wish to cease the feeding of your children, i.e. to wean your children, the fisal, you want to wean them, to stop them on the from the breast milk and to start them on food. عَنْ تَرَاضٍ مِّنْهُمَا, that the two, the husband and the wife, are both in agreement of that. وَتَشَاوَرٍ, and they both consult each other. فَلَا جُنَاحَ عَلَيْهِمَا, there's no harm in them weaning the child if the husband and wife both agree and both consult each other. And if you want to give your children to someone else to breastfeed, then there is no harm if you give them an amount of money in that which is ma'roof, that which is good and that which is customary, and have taqwa of Allah, and Allah is all seeing of what you do. So here it's just a simple point that when it comes to the matters of the feeding of the child and the weaning of the child, there is a degree of equivalence here, that there is a degree of, there has to be a taradi between the husband and the wife, and between there has to be a consultation between them in the matter of weaning the child and the matters relating to feeding the child or giving the child to someone else to feed. And this is something which is, as we said, it's not as common in our time that we have to deal with some of these issues, but perhaps the issue of weaning is one that we can give as an example when the child is weaned, whether it is 2 full years or whether it is less than that. That is a matter that is has to be a consultation between the husband and wife, and there has to be a mutual agreement between the husband and wife in that regard. So that brings us to the end of this episode, where we talked about some of the rights in which there is a great amount of equivalence or a lot of equivalence. And inshallah ta'ala, we're going to go on in the next episode to talk about the rights in which there is a degree of them being opposite to one another, one in exchange for another. And inshallah ta'ala, that's going to come up in the next episode. And Allah Azza wa Jal knows best. Wa salatu wa salam ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.
Assalamu alaikum. If you're enjoying these videos and you'd like to keep up to date with all of the courses we're going to be running, make sure you head over to amauathome.com.